Professor Chomsky, regarding Afghanistan, if U.S. troops pull out suddenly, will we not be leaving the people of Afghanistan, particularly women, at the tender mercies of the Taliban?
That's the debate that's going on. And like much of what happens, I think we ought to ask ourselves whether the right questions are being asked. You know, any scientist will tell you if you ask the wrong questions, you get crazy answers. The trick is to ask the right questions. The real question is, who's to make that decision? Do we have a right to make that decision? I mean, did the Russians have the right to make that decision in the 1980s? Actually, they debated the same point with some justice, probably more justice than we have. The Russians, if you look back at the debate in the night they invaded Afghanistan in the 1980s, and at least in some areas, like the capital, Kabul, women's education was carried out pretty extensively. Women were pretty free. They could dress the way they wanted and so on. They had problems. The main problem they had was that the U.S. favorites, the U.S.-backed terrorists like Gulbatin Hekmatyar, got their kicks out of throwing acid in the faces of women who weren't properly dressed by their standards. And they discussed seriously the fact that if they pulled out, they'd be exposing these women to the mercies of the U.S.-backed radical Islamist terrorist forces, which is incidentally what happened. As soon as they pulled back, a year or two later, the U.S.-run terrorist forces took over, and they practically destroyed Kabul. They instituted a system so hideous that when the Taliban came in, they were actually welcomed. Well, does that mean that the Russians shouldn't have made the decision to pull out? Well, no, I think they should have pulled out. But the point is, it wasn't their decision to make. The decision lies in the hands of the victims. Invading armies simply have no rights. They have no right to make any decisions. They have responsibilities, that's all. So you can't really answer the question, because the question presupposes something that we shouldn't accept, that we even have a right to make a decision. Well, what's likely to happen? We have some evidence about that. Nobody knows for sure. We'll be worse if we stay. It will be better if we stay. You can't answer that clearly any more than you could in the case of the Russian invasion. But we have, and as I say, it's not our decision to make. But there is some evidence about it. I mean, there are U.S.-run polls. Or Canadian-run polls, Western-run polls, and it's not easy to get a real feel of popular opinion in a country that's under military occupation, attacked from all sides. But they do have there's a pretty steady thread that runs through them. You look at the headlines, and they're not inaccurate. They say, yeah, the population would like us to remain, but they would like us to remain for aid and reconstruction. They don't ask us to stay with violence. And in fact, a large majority of the population of Afghanistan, at least judging by Western polls, seems to think that if the Western occupying armies withdrew, they'd find a way of resolving their problems among Afghans. They don't think, incidentally, that the Taliban would take over. A considerable majority think, well, we'll work it out somehow. And remember, the Taliban are not their only fear. There's also the U.S.-run backed warlords who are no better than the Taliban. I mean, in fact, there's a marvelous book about this, which if you haven't read, I suggest you should. It's by Malalai Joya. She's a marvelous young woman who is now not so young, but she lived through the Russian occupation, the U.S.-backed warlord monstrosities in the early 90s, the Taliban, and now today. She managed to get herself, all through this period, she's been working underground, running schools for girls, all sorts of things like that, exposing herself to enormous danger. She had a lot of popular support, enough so that she was elected to the parliament, but as she was thrown under the current government, as she was thrown out because she didn't shut up. She kept condemning the warlords who constitute the circles around the ruling government, and they threw her out. She's now living underground under heavy protection, but she talks. She even comes to the United States sometimes, in fact, maybe coming soon, and she has a very interesting book about this in detail, in which she concludes, in answer to the question, that the people of Afghanistan need an invasion of schools, hospitals, roads, but not an invasion of guns. And, you know, you can't be certain that one courageous person with plenty of support speaks for the population, but certainly speaks for them a lot more than General McChrystal or Barack Obama. And in fact, we do have we have good reason to believe that she's probably right. But to go back to the original point, it's just not our decision to make. I mean, we know what President Karzai himself has said. He was a US favorite up until Obama's election, and then he became a bad guy. And the reason's pretty straightforward. His first message to Obama was stop the military attacks against Afghan civilians and set a timetable for withdrawal of foreign forces, meaning US troops. Well, that's unacceptable. We're the ones who make those decisions, not you Afghans. I don't think much of him, nor does much of the Afghan population, but it's worth remembering that. Actually, I'll just end with one further comment. Recently, a couple of months ago, a British specialist on Afghanistan, Sir Roderick Braithwaite, who's high official in the British Joint Intelligence Community, working specifically on Afghanistan and Pakistan, has been ambassador. He was ambassador to Russia during the period when the main issue was their withdrawing from Afghanistan. Anyway, he just went on a personal tour through Afghanistan, in which he spoke to all sorts of people, and he came out with some interesting conclusions. They reported in the business press, as usual, British business press, not here. His main conclusion is that across the board, even among the strongest supporters of the US invasion, he said the most popular figure in Afghanistan, in their memory, is Najibullah. He was the communist-imposed dictator, basically, with a pretty miserable record himself, but who stayed on after the Russians withdrew and tried to maintain some kind of a functioning government until they were overwhelmed by the radical Islamist extremists, the Hekmatyars and others, who the Reagan administration had been backing, and he was finally murdered. You know, but he's the one person they remember with some, recent person with some respect. It's also, I said that would be the last comment, but one more. It's worth remembering that up until the 1980s, Afghanistan, you know, it's not just a tribal group of savages, and they're making real progress towards modernizing the society. To give just one example, having to do with women. Women got the vote in Afghanistan before they did in the United States. It's not a primitive society. And they can, there's every reason to suppose they could deal with their problems. They are now, as Joya points out, facing three major terrorist forces, the Taliban, the warlords who constitute the government, and the invading armies. And somehow they've got to be free of all of these. Well, it's up to them to decide how to do it, not us.